Like the 1969 Mets, it's the impossible dream. Plausible for some, improbable for others, but impossible not for the Dodgers. Those were just some of the words used to describe the year, the games, and the moments of the 1988 Dodger baseball season. Hi, I'm Vin Scully. All year long, and especially the last 2 weeks, everybody's trotted out the cliches about the Dodgers. You know, the dream team, the team of destiny, the Cinderella team. But really and truly, when you think about it, the one label that really holds up is world champion Los Angeles Dodgers. Oh, sure, this team typified all the great qualities that you can't put your hands on: determination, desire, heart. But they really won the World Series and won everything because of good fundamental baseball, solid pitching, good hitting, great fielding, and all in all, doing those things that are necessary to win the World Series. So for the next hour, pull up a chair, and we'll try and go back over some of those dramatic moments that got the Dodgers to the top of the baseball world. Began in October of 1987. Over a two-year period, the club had lost 178 games. Obviously, something had to happen. Dodgers owner Peter O'Malley made the first move, rehiring Fred Clair and Tom Lasorda.
Tommy is a proven championship-winning manager. Fred is a proven, established Major League Baseball executive. And I believe that everyone in the organization will support Fred and Tommy getting the Dodgers back into first place in 1988.
He is formulating a team that he thinks is going to be very, very good for the Dodgers. We feel that we can turn things around. He feels that we've got to turn things around.
When Fred Clair reflected on the team's disastrous back-to-back seasons, he knew some aspects of the Dodger attack was suspect, namely relief pitching and defense. He went shopping and came back with everything on his list.
You need a player to play every day, 162 game. I think 160 game, I think I can do that. And if I stay out of injury and give 100% every day.
I'm going to be the short man coming out of the pen. I'll go from the eighth inning on. They don't want to try to get me, you know, get me before the eighth, for the fact that I might not be able to come back the next day, and might as well come and bring me fresh every time.
If you want to make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and then make a change.
They don't want me to overextend myself right away. You know, I did have the surgery, and we want to take things one step at a time, but I think I'm on track, and my job is going to be getting hitters out. I mean, doesn't matter when or where, just get them out.
I hope I get an opportunity to play every day, and if I do, I think I should be pretty productive.
Our goal is to win, and what we do with these spring training, we will want to be world champions. We won't want to win our division or just the pennant. We're going to be coming back here to win a world championship.
I'm very, very optimistic. I'm enthused about this ball club. I think we're going to give our fans an exciting ball club, and we're going to give you announcers something very, very special to talk about in 88.
Steve Sachs seemed to be trying to make good on Gibson and Lasorda's words in the very first game of the year. He drove the first pitch into the left field seats, and the Dodgers were on their way. match Dwight Gooden broke shortstop Alfredo Griffin's hand with a fastball in the middle of May, Dave Anderson stepped in and paved the way for the emergence of the stuntmen. Took over first place on May 26th, and although they were challenged, they never looked back. Dodgers lost no more than three games in a row all year. Whenever it seemed they would self-destruct, someone stepped in to stem the tide.
Is swung on. High drive into right. Back goes Bronanski. Away back. It's a slam.
On the night of August 20th, Kirk Gibson set the emotional level for the rest of the season.
Still pitch to Shelby. The count, 1-2. John, and the ball gets by. Santovania, here comes Gibson. He's going to keep on coming. And throw to the plate. He scores. Dodgers win.
On September 11, the Dodgers staved off their last real challengers with a dramatic come-from-behind victory.
Franco is ready, and John delivers. Swung on, a high drive into deep left. Back goes Daniels. It's gone!
It was all over in the West except for the clinching.
That's hit well left field. Going back, Eldredi back to the wall. It's gone! Home run, Mickey Hatcher, and the Dodgers lead it 3-0.
There's probably two clubs in our division with more talent man for man than our ball club. Why are we winning? Well, it has to be the intangibles, and we've done little things all year. We've got guys that have been great role players. I think that's the reason why we're winning.
So I tell you what, about this time of the year last year, we couldn't wait for this thing to get over with.
Unlike last year, the Dodgers will have to wait to get it over with. The clinch week began in San Francisco with Oral Hershiser doing his part by pitching his fifth consecutive shutout, increasing his scoreless inning streak to 49. On Saturday, September the 24th, the Dodgers jumped all over the Giants, but needed a little southern hospitality from Atlanta to clinch the division against, of all people, Oral Hershiser's Cy Young Award rival, Danny Jackson.
It's a moment to enjoy. We are waiting for the moment to enjoy it even more, but today's results, the results this far this season, have been very gratifying for all of us in the Dodger organization.
A Reds win on Saturday postponed the celebration at least one more day.
Beat LA
is exactly what San Francisco did. A former waiter, Dennis Cook, served up a loss. And with Cincinnati already winning, it was a real yawner. Time to pack up the bats, keep the champagne on ice for one more day.
You don't want to see them clinch it here. Let them clinch it, you know, wherever, in San Diego or at home.
No time to talk of destiny. Right now's reality.
power, a premonition. One night later in San Diego, Mickey Hatcher was the hero. Under a harvest moon, the rise to the top was complete. Division race was over, but the drama in San Diego was just beginning.
Well, I'll tell you, I think all good things have to come to an end, and this, I knew it was going to happen sooner or later. It was too much to expect it to go on forever, but
I am very happy. The 1-2 pitch is swung on, a fly ball to right. Gonzalez backs up, he's got it, and Hershiser has the record. The Dodgers now are going to go all out to greet him. Everyone in a uniform down there. What an incredible performance Oral Hershiser has turned in. And what a magnificent goal he has attained.
You never even think about breaking a record like this. This is the record that when people ask me what record in baseball is going to stand forever, this is the one I used to say. Now I think somebody's going to break it from me because I know I'm not any big deal. When I tied it, I just got on my knee there when Hamilton threw the ball over there and just thanked God for him catching it and throwing it first in the air. And then Stubbs caught it. And then after I broke it, I just thanked God again, and I just kept going forward. And I thought it wouldn't have been all bad to have two Dodgers just sitting up there on top as a tie. But I was convinced by higher sources that they weren't going to take me out of the game. So I figured I might as well get the guy out.
My congratulations to a great guy. They call him the Bulldog here, and I think all of you have been able to witness that and see why, and at least we kept it in the family. That's the big thing.
Some thought that Oral's magnificent achievement, along with the Dodgers winning the National League Western Division title, would be a perfect ending for the 1988 Los Angeles season. But the Dodgers had completely different ideas. When we come back, we'll see how the Dodgers took a bite out of the Big Apple of New York. Regular season, many experts and most fans figured that it would be impossible for the Dodgers to win four. Had lost 10 of the 11 games with the New York Mets during the regular year.
They lead the league in hitting, they lead the league in pitching, they lead the league in home runs, they lead the league in least home runs given, they lead the league in total bases. I mean, what am I doing?
Tommy Lasorda knew what he was up against as the writers and broadcasters focused the attention of the baseball world on Dodger Stadium.
And Marshall trying to pick up sacks in third. Gooden, another look over. Now the 1-0 pitch on the way to Marshall, and that's right.
The seal had just been broken on game one when Mike Marshall singled in the first Dodger run against the Mets ace, Dwight Gooden. With Oral Hershiser on the mound for the Dodgers, this figured to be an LCS classic. Oral shut out the Mets for 8 1/3 inning. Gooden held his own, yielding one more run through 7 innings. With New York down 2-0 in the ninth, Darryl Strawberry broke up Hershiser's shutout with a double into the gap in right. Jay Howell relieved, and Gary Carter lifted a fly ball to short center. John Shelby could not catch it. The Mets took a 3-2 lead as Kevin McReynolds steamrolled Mike Socha at the plate. Randy Myers got the win as New York grasped the lead in the series.
The key was winning the first game because, you know, we got David Cone on the mound tomorrow. 20-game winner for us is pitching extremely well, and we have to feel very confident after coming back winning that game.
Mets pitcher David Cone was to find out that the Dodger bats were mightier than his pen. His New York Daily News article became the kindling that ignited the Dodger spirit in game two. Mickey Hatcher took Cone's remarks about teammate Jay Howell personally, and the Dodgers got better than even. Already leading 1-0, Hatcher celebrated the end of Cone's writing career with a 2-run double down the line in left. Davey Johnson knew he was in trouble. His most consistent starter was to give up 5 runs in only 2 innings. Meanwhile, Tim Belcher threw strikes for 8 1/3 innings, blowing away 10 Mets. Alejandro Pena held off a Mets rally in the ninth, and the Dodgers had made their point against Cone and the Mets.
It's kind of uncharacteristic coming from him, because I've heard him in other interviews, and he seems somewhat humble. I don't know what was going through his mind. Maybe it was just the excitement of last night's game that made him write those things, but I think it backfired on him.
David Cohn, who was visibly upset when Dodger fans shook the Richter scale on Game 2, apologized after the game to Jay Howell. But Jay was to find another storm brewing in New York. It wasn't an earthquake that shook Shea Stadium in Game 3. It was an October nor'easter. After Friday's rainout, the makeup game on Saturday was played in a cold, steady rain. Both teams were affected by the soggy turf and muddy infield. The Dodgers held on precariously to a 4-3 lead in the eighth inning, and they had Jay Howell, their closer, on the mound. Then Davey Johnson made his move. Searching for an illegal substance inside Jay Howell's glove, umpire Harry Wendelstedt found what Johnson was looking for: pine tar. To the disbelief of Tommy Lasorda, Howell was ejected from the game. A succession of three Dodger relievers turned a one-run lead into a four-run deficit as the Mets rallied for a dramatic and controversial 8-4 victory.
You're all well aware of the reasons why I used the pine tar yesterday in the game. The conditions were adverse. And I think that some players have come forward and substantiated that it does not change in any way or alter the flight of the ball. And my intent certainly was not to cheat in any way. And that is the simple truth of the whole thing.
Saturday's loss and the extraordinary circumstances surrounding it put the Dodgers in the sticky position of being down 2-1 in a best of seven series. And they would have to face the Mets' Dwight Gooden in Game 4, with Jay Howell suspended for 3 days. The championship series wore on. You wondered just how much the Dodgers had left. They were down 2-1. They were trailing 4-2 in the ninth inning because of home runs by Darryl Strawberry and Kevin McReynolds. But more than that, with three outs left to go, they were facing Dwight Gooden, who appeared unhittable. Then they caught lightning in a bottle. Socia turned it around, and Kirk Gibson turned the tide to give the Dodgers wins in games 4 and 5, but it was no time to celebrate. Kirk Gibson was on the dreaded day-to-day list with two sore legs, and the Dodgers headed home for game 6 at Dodger Stadium emotionally flat.
Lina, no problem.
The Dodger bats came up a little short on Tuesday night.
Take this redwood tree.
The mood around Dodger Stadium was pumped up for Game 7. Even the most experienced had butterflies.
I've got 24 years in the league. I've worked a lot of tough games, and I'll tell you what, my knees are shaking.
But the butterflies turned into bluebirds, and they soared.
Being waved in
The throw to the plate, not in time. 4-0.
It has been Hershiser's night, and he looks in now to make what he hopes will be his last pitch. Spilling out of the dugout, racing to engulf Hershiser on the mound. Many of the fans now running on the field, and the Dodger team has safely made it to the dugout and down to the dressing room.
Well, this ball club's got a ton of heart, and really the main reason is because we're not very dominant. You know, we just have a lineup that goes out there and produces runs when they can, and when they don't, hopefully we get a good pitch game. And when the starter falters, we've got an unbelievable bullpen, and it's just a team of balance.
We're the dream team. Tommy calls us the dream team, and I think a lot of people think that they're dreaming that we're going to the World Series.
Ain't no dream. It's reality.
An amazing year, an amazing team, because it was a team that would just never quit. Nobody picked us to win, but the team would not quit. It's just a team of great desire.
It had been 14 years since the Dodgers had met the Oakland A's. In the 1974 World Series, Oakland had beaten the Dodgers 4-1. And now they were coming to town with one of the most formidable lineups in all of the major leagues, along with former Dodgers Bob Welch, Dave Stewart, and Rick Honeycutt. Of course, pitchers Tim Belcher and Jay Howell, shortstop Alfredo Griffin, and outfielder Mike Davis had been Oakland A's. The Dodgers and Athletics renewed some old friendships.
They're right here. Take a shot. He's going to let me get a hit off.
I'm going to talk to you.
And built some new ones around the batting cage while the inevitable buildup and assessment of Game 1 began.
You would have to think that the A's will win this series. They certainly on paper have a better team, but as we all know, they play on a field, they don't play on paper.
It isn't totally surprising that the Dodgers got here. They're a very fine baseball team.
I couldn't see them getting past the Mets. I did pick them to win the National League West, though, and the one catalyst was Kirk Gibson. I really felt that if any one free agent was available, that this was the one person that could put some life into this team, and he sure did.
I am a fan, and I will take pleasure in cheering the Dodgers tonight.
Right off the bat, Don Baylor provided some motivation for the Dodgers. The San Jose newspaper interview in which he ripped Dodger Jay Howell was posted in the clubhouse. With Kirk Gibson unable to start, the Dodgers needed motivation, and Mickey Hatcher stepped into the breach. Hatcher's home run gave starter Tim Belcher an early 2-0 lead, but the rookie pitcher, obviously pressing in his first World Series, gave Tommy Lasorda cause for worry. And there's a drive to center. Back goes Shelby to the wall. It is gone. Grand slam home run for Jose Canseco. Belcher was relieved by Tim Leary, who got control of the situation and ended up pitching 3 scoreless innings. Brian Holden took over and continued where Leary left off. Their fine relief work gave the Dodgers a chance to come back, with Kirk Gibson only able to watch. Pena slammed the door on Oakland in the ninth, and the stage was set. Bottom of the ninth, A's 4, Dodgers 3. 3-1. And he walked him. And look who's coming up.
We all play the game for moments like this, some very, very tough moments. I mean, I'm the type of guy who, can look very terrible at times, but I'm the type of guy you want to leave in there even if I do look bad, because I might be able to do something. Just trying to stay relaxed and stay square right, stay square to the plate and be, try and get a ball and just stay back and let my hands do the work, and that's what happened.
Dramatic moment was the subject of much discussion the next day.
The moment last night, it's going to be one of those Carlton Fisk, Babe Ruth, whatever you want to give it.
Probably the most incredible moment I've ever experienced in sports. There was no way that was going to happen, and yet it happened.
When I saw the ball hit the bat, I couldn't believe it. I knew it was out as soon as he hit it, but I still couldn't believe it.
He hit the ball one-handed. He also hit it one-legged. His left foot is up in the air, so he's on his right leg, swinging with his right hand.
The minute I saw Canseco take, he might have taken a couple steps in this turn and watch. I said, oh, no, this guy hit the ball that far.
It really personified what the game is all about. There's no time limit. You have to get the other team out 27 times, and if you don't, and the guy hits home run, you got more runs in the bottom of the ninth, you win.
Destiny does play a part somewhat in these kind of games, and if it's been scripted, then it's been scripted by a studio that's a little higher than Hollywood.
it was amazing. Lasorda, he keeps talking about it. He's right. People ought to come out here instead of Lourdes. You know, they can fly coach and save some money.
So Kirk Gibson's home run was indeed miraculous, and the Dodgers won game one. It was going to be a very tough act to follow, but Oral Hershiser was going to do just that in game two. Oral's mother and father set the tone for the game by throwing strikes on the ceremonial first pitch. Meanwhile, Oral did surgery on the Athletics. And when Oakland managed to get base runners, the Dodger infield went to work on the DP combination. Mike Marshall hit one out to give the Dodgers an early lead, but Hershiser was the real hitting star. His three hits equaled the entire output of the A's team. The master of the house gave the Dodgers a 6-0 win and a 2-0 lead in the World Series. For Bulldog, it was just another day at the office. His teammates would certainly not agree.
If I ever thought God took over somebody's body to play the game, it had to be Oral Hershiser, because, man, I tell you what, he's been amazing. He's done a lot of fantastic stuff.
He's on a different level. After the season's over, I'm sure that level of play that's above the major leagues will draft him number one. He belongs in a different league. There's a handful of players that I believe that don't belong in the major leagues, and he'd be the number one pitcher in that the ultra league.
So the Dodgers had thrown their best ultra league hitter and their best ultra league pitcher against Oakland and had come away 2-0. And now they were heading for the Oakland Coliseum in the beautiful San Francisco Bay Area. Oh, Monday was listed as an off day for the fans, but for the Oakland A's, it meant a chance to regroup. And for the Dodgers, a chance to get the feel of the Oakland Coliseum. The weather was much like L.A. The players loosened up at the Coliseum with temperatures in the 80s. Was Oakland calling on some heavy artillery for Game 3? Well, not even the Marines could help. Players and coaches knew exactly what they had to do to turn it around.
We've been down before. You know, we didn't go out and just win every ball game that we were faced up with. We've come back, and our goal is, like we've played during the year, is to win a series.
Only 8 Athletics showed up for their optional workout, but Coach Bob Watson warned L.A. a 2-0 series lead is not safe.
I was on a ball club in 1981 that was up 2 games, and we ended up losing 4 in a row to this club over here in the Gray. So I can't believe that they feel that they have a lock on anything, because they were on the other side, you know, just some, you know, 7 or 8 years ago.
I'm going to use it. Where's your bag?
For Alfredo Griffin, Monday was deja vu, getting to loosen up in his home for many productive seasons. It was also the day to evaluate the progress of Game 1 hero, Kirk Gibson. Although 7 of his 46 pitches were hit into the seats, chances were dim he'd have any more impact on this '88 Fall Classic. because of his knee and hamstring injuries. Dr. Frank Jobe, Dodger orthopedic surgeon, said if this was the regular season, he would definitely be on the disabled list.
Tommy said it's pretty much up to you whether you're going to go.
Well, I can't run, so I mean, he figured out. There's only one hope for me.
Well, it could be a pinch hitter, but you're thinking designated hitter?
How am I going to designate a hit when I can't run? We're not here because of me. We're here because of us, and that's the way it has been. That's the way it'll continue to be. So if we win, we'll win together, and we'll lose together.
The biggest question going into Game 3, would the sun be setting on the prohibitive favorites from Northern California in this Golden State Series?
Don't worry, be happy.
Northern California's team. The new day spawned renewed enthusiasm for the area's first World Series in 14 years. The cameras were poised. The A's were marking time. Some fans were pushing Tommy Lasorda into politics. Others into the deity.
No more pasta, Tommy! It's apple time!
Watch his reactions. As a catcher,
did the A's Green Witch put the curse on Tommy's troops? John Tudor left the game with a sore elbow after just an inning and a third. Mike Marshall's sore back forced him out of the game a short time later.
We're a little short now, but the injuries are part of the game.
Relief pitcher Jay Howell spent a lot of time with his fans in Oakland before Game 3. Just a few hours later, he delighted 49,000 of them by serving up a game-winning pitch to Rod Dedeaux's former USC pupil, Mark McGwire. And the Oakland A's were back on the mark in the 88 Fall Classic.
Been getting some pretty good cuts at the plate, and they've been coming pretty much fastball after fastball, but it was just a matter of time for me to get my bat around and actually get a good ball to hit. And I finally got around and hit a line drive and went out of the ballpark.
They really didn't outplay us. I mean, they beat us by the home run in the last inning, and that's one of those things. I don't blame Jay Howell at all. I mean, we should have had more runs on the board for him. And it was just one of them situations, another exciting game for the fans and another exciting game for me.
Would Game 4 be another nightmare on A's Street for the Dodgers? Would L.A. be barbecued for a second straight night? Would Tommy Lasorda need acupuncture treatment after the witch's green and gold hex from Tuesday night? These questions would all be answered in Game 4.
I love it. I love it.
Did I get it in my throat?
Okay.
Home run, but I brought it back to see another home run he hit.
Did we hear him correctly? Beat Oakland? You'd better whisper that up here, fella. But beat Oakland, L.A. did, scrambling and manufacturing a 4-3 win. The Dodgers were battling more just to keep an ambulatory team on the field than the A's highly touted Bash brothers.
We've been through a lot of adversity all year long, and we've always came through. People thought we were going to bend, but we didn't. They thought we were going to break, but we didn't. We've always held together. It seems like every time a guy goes down, the team gets a little bit closer together, and that's the way it's been all year.
I like our situation. I still don't feel that anything's in hand, because it's not. These guys are a great team, and we have to stay very, very humble, which we are, because you can never say die with a team like the A's.
Just pray to God that we can put it together one more time, and we set out from spring training to become world champs, and it's the ultimate challenge. It's very, very elusive, and we just give anything to be able to say that we're world champs again. We certainly don't care how we do it. We just want to be world champs.
The Oakland fans stood motionless in the stands for several minutes. They couldn't believe their beloved A's. The sweepers of the Red Sox for the American League crown were a game from elimination against a battered, bruised bunch of B-teamers wearing Dodger blue.
You have lost four players now. You're playing with 20 players, basically.
We're playing as a team is the most important part. And when one person goes down, another person is there to pick up the guy who went down. And I think that's the thing that's really enabled us to reach this point. It is a great collective team spirit. There's a oneness to this team that few teams in history have had.
And as history would have it, a Tommy Lasorda tip of the cap to reliever Jay Howell, who, like a heavyweight champ, pulled himself up from the Game 3 canvas to Game 4 supremacy, punching out Jose Canseco in the ninth and Game 3 nemesis Mark McGwire in the seventh inning. Tracy Woodson.
I felt like, I was very close to diving into Piranha. I mean, he's a tough hitter, given last night. I just wanted to make a good pitch and not think about last night, and just carry on and think about making a good pitch.
I was so proud of Jay Howe and what he did tonight, because reading the newspapers today, he got blistered. A lot of people said he didn't have the stomach to be a good relief pitcher. A lot of people said he couldn't do this and he couldn't do that. And I told him today before the game, I said, if the occasion arises, I'll get you right back in that ball game. Because if it had been for Jay Howe, we would have never been able to be in the Fall Classic. Our guys are a yard offshore. They must get on the beach. They cannot drown. They must work hard to get that fourth one. They have done absolutely nothing winning three games. If you win three in the best of five, you've done the job. We're in the best of seven, you need four. They need one more, and they got to go after it with all the vengeance they have within them.
And that vengeance didn't take long to manifest itself. Mickey Hatcher, the World Series stuntman MVP, staked Oral Hershiser to an early lead with this first inning home run. Then, just three innings later, Mike Davis turned into a World Series hero with this two-run blast. What a successful homecoming game for Mike Davis. Then it was up to Oral Hershiser. The Bulldog was up to the challenge, and the Dodgers, those underdogs from Hollywood, etched the final scene in one of the most amazing screenplays ever written in America's movie capital.
There it is, right there. The Dodgers on the top of the mountain. The world, look at it, Greg, what I'm talking to you. The top, look at it.
There it is, it's right there.
Right there, the top of the mountain. And the world champions of baseball. Keep looking, Greg. What's the matter with you? Look at that team up there. There it is. The world champions. Look up there, Greg. Keep looking, Greg.
Destiny's darlings, Tommy.
I don't think I'll believe it until they give me a ring, because so much has happened. There's so much pressure. There's so much to go through, and I've been blocking it all out so that it wouldn't affect me on the mound. So to believe, to even think that we've done it is just beyond comprehension.
There's been some things slandered our way, some things said about some individuals, some things said about our club. But they can call us anything we want, just as long as they don't forget one thing, we're the world champs.
World champion, Los Angeles Dodgers. Got a nice ring to it?
You didn't say it loud enough. You gotta say, whoa! are champions. That's what we are. Oh, man. Awesome. This is what I dreamed about this when I was 10 years old, and to let it come true is unbelievable.
The club just fought back, and, you know, it's funny. When people are doubting, but these guys came back. It was a very gutsy group, and so it's fun to watch them win.
In ballparks throughout the league. The losers of 86 and 87 became the world champions of 1988. We sure hope you enjoyed looking back at the year, the games, and the moments that made it a great Dodger season. Moments that will echo throughout Dodger Stadium for many years to come.
Bases loaded, 3-2, and the pitch is swung on. John delivered. Swung on, a high drive into deep left. Back goes Daniels. It's gone.
And he looks in now to make what he hopes will be his last pitch. Fastball got him looking. Pandemonium at Dodger Stadium, as you can well imagine.
Sacks waiting on deck.
The glasses. Here's to the glory still to be. Here's to the battle, whatever it's for, to ask the best of ourselves, then give much more. Here's to the heroes, those who move mountains. Here's to the miracles they make us see. The miracles they make us see.